You can see a video game that's photorealistic, almost photorealistic, and millions of people playing simultaneously, and you see where things are going with virtual reality and augmented reality. And if you extrapolate that out into the future with any rate of progress at all, like even 0.1% or something like that a year, then eventually those games will be indistinguishable from reality. They'll be so realistic, you will not be able to tell the difference between that game and the reality as we know it. And then it seems like, well, how do we know that that didn't happen in the past? And that we're not in one of those games ourselves?
You look at our computing power today, and you say, I have the power to program a world inside of a computer. Well, imagine in the future where you have even more power than that, and you can create characters that have, for example, free will, or their own perception of free will. So this is a world, and I program in the laws that govern that world. That world will have its own laws of physics and chemistry and biology. Now, you're a character in that world, and you think you have free will, and you say, I want to invent a computer. So you do. Hey, I want to create a world in my computer. And then that world creates a world in its computer. And then you have simulations all the way down. So now you lay out all these universes and throw a dart. Which of these universes are you most likely to hit? The original one that started it? Or the countless simulations, the daughter simulations that unfolded thereafter? You're going to hit one of the simulations. So statistically, based on that argument, which first appeared by a philosopher from Oxford named Nick Bostrom back in the 1990s, right when computers were becoming real enough to think this through. It's hard to argue against the possibility that all of us are not just the creation of some kid in a parent's basement programming up a world for their own entertainment. And then every time something weird happens in the world, some disruptive leader takes charge, and I wonder if that programmer just got bored and had to stir the pot. So they throw somebody in there just to, for their own entertainment. For me, that's some of the best evidence that we live in a simulation, because this happens every time there's peace and tranquility in the world.
The idea would be that if there is one day the ability to create a simulation, that it would be indiscernible from reality itself. That if, like, say if we're not in a simulation yet, if this is just biological life, we're just extremely mm-hmm. fortunate to be in this Goldilocks period, but we're working on virtual reality in terms of, like, Oculus, and all these companies are creating these consumer-based virtual reality things that are getting better and better and really kind of interesting, that you got to imagine that 20 years ago there was nothing like that. 20 years from now, it might be indiscernible. One day they will have an artificial reality that's indiscernible from reality itself. And if that is the case, how do we know if we're in it?
So there are these attempts to try to figure out the computational requirements that would be required if you wanted to simulate some physical system with perfect precision. So if we have some human, a brain, a room, let us say, and we wanted to simulate every little part, every atom, every subatomic particle, the whole quantum wave function, what would be the computational load of that? And would it be possible to build a computer powerful enough that you could actually do this? Now, I think the way that this misses the point is that it's not necessary to simulate all the details of this environment that you want to create in an ancestry simulation. You would only have to simulate it insofar as it is perceptible to the observer inside the simulations. They'd need to simulate whatever parts of the environment that you are able to perceive. So surface appearances, maybe off the table and walls. Maybe they would need to simulate me as well, or at least a good enough simulacrum that I could sort of spit out words that would sound like they came from a real human, right? I don't know. Now we're getting quite good with this GPT-2, like this kind of AI that just spews out words. Anyway, so you'd have, but like what is happening inside this table right now is completely irrelevant. You have no idea of knowing whether there even are atoms there. Now you could take a big electron microscope and look at finer structure, and then you could take an atomic force microscope and you could see individual atoms even, and you could perform all kinds of measurements. And it might be important that if you did that, you wouldn't see anything weird, because physicists do these experiments and they don't see anything weird. But then you could kind of fill in those details, like if and when somebody were performing those experiments. That would be vastly cheaper than continuously running all of this. And so this is the way a lot of computer games are designed today, that they have a certain rendering distance. Like you only like actually simulate the virtual world when the character goes close enough that you could see it. And so I imagine these kind of super intelligent post-humans doing this, obviously they would have figured that out and a lot of other optimizations.
If the simulation hypothesis is valid, then we open the door to eternal life and resurrection and things that formerly have been discussed in the realm of religion. And the reason is really quite simple, because if you think about a computer, if we are a simulation, then we're like programs in a computer. As long as I have a computer that's not damaged, I can always rerun the program, right? So if you really believe that we are in a simulation, and there's some structure that runs that simulation, unless something damages that structure, then we are we can be repurposed. And so it starts to break down a very funny barrier between the what people often think is the conflict between science and the conflict between faith.
I think most likely, this is just about probability, there are many, many simulations. These simulations are, we might as well call them reality, or you could call them multiverse. Well, when we create a simulation, like a game or a movie, it's a distillation of what's interesting about life. You know, like it can take a year to shoot an action movie, and then that's all distilled down into 2 or 3 hours. So let me tell you, if you see an action movie being filmed, it's friggin' boring. Super boring. There's like lots of takes, everything's in a green screen. Looks pretty goofy, doesn't look cool. But once you add the CGI and have great editing, it's amazing. So I think most likely, if we're a simulation, it's really boring outside the simulation. Because why would you make a simulation that's boring? You'd make the simulation way more interesting than the base reality.
What happens if our program crashes? Do we all disappear? Like, instantly? What are the consequences to this being a program if someone unplugs it? If there's a bug that crashes the entire system? Is there any piece of the universe where that part of the program failed?
The point you raise, in fact, is, for me, one of the most uncomfortable ideas about the simulation hypothesis. That it's running on some device, and that the errors would then, how would it manifest itself? Well, in the way that I think most of us think about it, it's kind of the end of the universe. And for me, the universe that I have studied for 50 or 60 years is a kind of it's a place of mystery, but it's not a place of the fundamental kind of insane, unleashed chaos that that kind of end. Now, we know that we talk about, for example, false vacua. We know that these possibilities are out there, but the breaking of the symmetries are so... One thing that's really odd about this is if you don't break the symmetries, you don't get us. You don't get a universe with creatures like us in it unless you break these symmetries. The fact of our existence says something very deep about the mystery of this place we call the universe.
So given that we're clearly on a trajectory to have games that are indistinguishable from reality, and those games could be played on any set-top box or on a PC or whatever, and there would probably be, you know, billions of such computers or set-top boxes, it would seem to follow that the odds that we're in base reality is 1 in billions.